Okay, so Universal Analytics is being sunset, and now you know you need to get started with this GA4 business. You've done the first bit and watched a video about the main differences between UA and GA4. You've heard that GA4 is all about events, and now you want to double click on this whole events thing. You want to know how the events in GA4 function and learn just enough to be able to get GA4 set up without stumbling on the concept of events. I will mention here that I have focused more on the web portion of GA4, but obviously one of the cool new features of GA4 is that it collects web and app data, but I'll tackle the app side of things in another video. So let's get started. Hits in GA versus events in GA4. And if you never worked with Universal Analytics, you can skip this part. No need to confuse yourself with the old way of doing things. But if you've been working in Universal Analytics for years, I'm going to explain the difference. Okay, so events existed, but only as a type of hit, which was a subset of sessions, which was a subset of users. Basically, UA recorded a user coming to your site and starting a session. It then recorded the actions that user took during that session, which is recorded as hits. Then, if you decided to track anything else that the user did that wasn't already included as a hit in GA, you could create an event to track it. Now imagine all of that is now events, and that some events are built into GA4, and some events need to be created as custom, which is much easier to wrap your head around. Now, whatever you want to track on your website, whether it is how many times someone clicks on your pricing page or how much of your blog they actually scroll through, it's an event. Let's do a quick analogy to help understand events then. Let's imagine a physical lemonade stand selling, well, lemonade. Now let's imagine that lemonade stand has a scribe, kind of like a court scribe that writes everything down, in a courtroom, but except today it's not a courtroom, it's a lemonade stand. And rather than writing everything down, they decide to make a note of four things. The first one's every time someone walks up to the stand. The second, every time someone makes an order. The third, every time someone pays. And fourth, every time someone says thank you. Each one of those things is an event at the lemonade stand. And the reason we're collecting events could be to, say, analyze how the day of selling lemonade went. Or maybe it's so we can plan how much lemonade to make tomorrow. Maybe it's to, I don't know, even forecast how much money we'll make from selling lemonade this summer. Or maybe it's because we're planning a big expansion of a second lemonade stand. Like pretty entrepreneurial for a lemonade stand, I would say. Anyway, whatever the motivation is, the point is that we need information to make all of those decisions rather than relying on gut feeling. So, rather than dealing with sessions and hits and some events, etc., GA4 makes it simpler to grasp. Everything's an event. Well, apart from parameters, which I'll explain shortly, and well, custom dimensions and metrics, but all of them are related to events in the end. I mentioned everything is an event and that there are different types of events. So let me run you through each one. First up, we have automatically collected events, which are basically predefined events that most businesses will want to track on their website, including first visit, session start, and user engagement. As the name suggests, these events are automatically collected and don't require any setup in Google Tag Manager. Next up, we have enhanced measurement events, which enable marketers to capture even more web behavior data without the need for that technical help, which again means there's no requirement to set these events up in Google Tag Manager. They include page view, scroll, outbound link click, site search, video engagement, which includes things like video start, video progress, and video complete, and then you've got file download as well. Once you turn this on, there are some customization options available, but nothing to really speak of. Then you've got recommended events, which do require code on your site, and they can be pretty easily implemented with Google Tag Manager. But they are slightly different from custom events because Google has already done some of the thinking for you in terms of naming conventions. As you can imagine, the list of recommended events includes quite a few, but a few examples are purchase, refund, and search. Finally, we have custom events. This is where the real potential of GA4 comes alive. Custom events are very similar to recommended events, but essentially you can create any data point that you want. Let's say you already have scroll being collected as an enhanced measurement. Scroll by default is when someone scrolls to 90% of the page. But let's say you want to have data available on when website visitors scroll 25, 50, and 75% of your page. You'd need to set up the event in Google Tag Manager and then receive it in GA4. I will note here there are some best practices that you should follow, but I'll touch on them in the next section. Okay, so this is actually the point in the video where I need to explain parameters. Don't skip it because it actually is important for understanding the potential events in GA4 and how to think about them. Simply, parameters are other pieces of information that are collected with an event. Let's go back to the lemonade stand. Remember, we were collecting the following. Every time someone walks up to the stand, every time someone makes an order, every time someone pays, and every time someone says thank you. Now, let's say we are going to collect some parameters. So for every time someone walks up to the stand, we want to also collect their gender. That would be a parameter. Let's say for every time someone makes an order, we want to also collect how many lemonades they order. Then for every time someone pays, we want to know what denomination of money they paid with, 20s, 10s, or 5s. You get the picture. Parameters collect extra information that can be used when we get to analysis. So you can find out, for example, whether men or women bought the most lemonade. So you can find out a way of getting the one who buys less to buy more, thus creating your average order value. Okay, so now we've covered parameters, it's important to know that all automatic events already collect a set of standard parameters, which I will include a link to below the video. But you can also add custom parameters to automatic and enhanced measurement events. Then you have recommended and custom events, which also have standard parameters that are always collected, but you can obviously add your own custom parameters too. I know it's a little bit confusing, but taking our lemonade analogy a step further, we said for every time someone walks up to the stand, we would collect their gender. Let's imagine that is always a standard parameter. And we wanted to add a few custom parameters like whether they walked or drove in a car, whether they have a child with them, whether they have tattoos, and whether they said hello or hey. That would be me adding a host of custom parameters that don't come as standard with each event that's created. Lastly, on parameters, in order to actually use the information collected in events and parameters, you will need to create them as custom dimensions or custom metrics. Otherwise, you can see parameters in the events name section within the engagement section of reports, but you won't even see them in the explore section. And the explores is where you'll be able to make the most of your custom parameters. So make sure you create them as custom metrics and dimensions if you want to use them. All right, hopefully you're clued up on events. Now let's talk through some best practices so you can work optimally with events, because we want clean data, not dirty data. Number one, use snake casing, which if you're not familiar, is just replacing each space with an underscore and the first letter of each word is written in lowercase. The reason you should do this is because auto and enhanced events are already using it, so it's cleanest to continue. Number two, plan ahead. I've already talked about parameters, but ask yourself the following questions to figure out what to include. Which scope do they have? User, event, and maybe even later, session and item. Is it a numeric value where calculations would make sense? Then make it a metric. Involve your colleagues. Other departments might have some input, especially given that this data is likely to leave GA at some point and, you know, get piped into your data hub for people to clean and actually analyze. Number three, think privacy first. What I mean here is to think about whether a particular data point could possibly be considered personal data. A good example here would be collecting the string of a free text field in a form like first and last name, or any other data that is considered personally identifiable. Number four, don't clutter your GA4. I get it. New possibilities bring tons of excitement, but just because you can track something doesn't mean you should. Try and ascertain if it's actually useful for you and your business. Start small, start clean, and then build from there. Number five, don't just set it and forget it. Remember, even though GA4 is taking over, it is technically still in beta, and changes are constantly being made. So conduct regular health checks to ensure events are still firing and sending the correct data. Lastly, I just want to note that you have about a year until UA is deprecated. My recommendation is to get started with GA4 and run it alongside UA, so you can get to grips with GA4, then when the time is right and you feel comfortable with GA4, switch over. Oh, and make sure you have all of your UA data in a marketing data hub so you can continue doing things like year-on-year analysis. Alrighty, that's it for events in GA4. You should be clued up enough on events to understand them and start exploring, or even implementing them by yourself. But before you do, I do recommend watching a couple of videos about Google Tag Manager, because that is where most of the implementation actually is. Don't forget to subscribe for more marketing data videos and marketing strategy inspiration. That's it for me.